Yo, what is up, everybody? It is your boy Zeta here, back at it again to drop part 3 for What If Deku Was Taskmaster. Now, on the last part, I had basically left off with Deku essentially humiliating Bakugo in the Heroes vs. Villains event, and before the video does get started, I probably will be giving a little bit of a mini recap after the intro. That being said though, guys, I don't want to waste you guys' time too much. Make sure you guys tell a friend to tell another friend, like the video, as you know, I will appreciate it, and maybe, you know, share the video around to some friends, some anime friends who like My Hero Academia and just so happen to watch the Marvel movie. That being said, this intro's been long enough, so I'm just gonna say one more thing before I start it. Hit it! Okay, so I know I said that I was going to be giving a little bit of a mini intro before this part started. However, I honestly got a little bit lazy, therefore, probably not gonna be doing that anymore. That being said, let's get into today's story. So, we pick off our story with Bakugo basically waking up angry at the fact that he can't wake beat Izuku. This moment, Bakugo would barely be waking up in Recovery Girl's office, and Bakugo would just be like, what happened? This is when Bakugo would be shown footage of what happened exactly. And Bakugo's eyes would just widen as he remembers the final words Deku said to him before he finally knocked him out. Deku told him, "You were never able to beat me before, and you're not going to be able to beat me now." As he literally proceeded to knock him out, and Bakugo would literally just sit there and think that same thought in his head. He couldn't beat him then, and he can't beat him now. No matter how hard he trained, no matter how much blood, sweat, and tears he put in, he never got stronger than Deku. Deku just always kept evolving, getting more powerful, while Bakugo just stayed progressively getting slower. And this realization would truly hit Bakugo. This is when Bakugo would go home extremely angry, and he would decide that he needs to let out some anger. So he would go to the gym, and he would start working out. This is when we're going to switch over to Deku's point of view, and Deku would literally just put all of his stuff down. He would put his backpack to the side, take a shower, and he would start watching some YouTube video. He would get in his laptop and be like, "Huh, Zether just posted a new video? Crazy. What if Naruto was a Saiyan Part 3? What?" Make sure you guys go check it out, you know. Do your boy a favor. That being said, enough fourth wall breaking. Zether would literally, no, not Zether, but Deku would literally proceed to, I'm really about to try to tell a story about myself. Anyways, Deku would basically just relax that entire day, and this is when we're basically just going to have about 1 week of normal school activities. There's literally going to be nothing going on up until the day of the USJ. See, this is when we are now going to finally start covering some of the juicier stuff. Of course, the students would all be on the bus, and Suyu would be talking about who she thinks is the strongest. Of course, since Deku, his quirk isn't that flashy, and Suyu is kind of on the, like, very bold side, I think Suyu's the type of person who would be like, "Ribbit, Todoroki's the best." You know, like, I hate Suyu's voice. Like, I don't know what it is. I don't like Suyu's voice. Some Suyu tards are probably down there just like, "What do you mean you don't like Suyu's voice? Kill yourself. Do us all a favor." And I'm just going to be here like, hey, bro, chill. But anyways, that being said, this is when, you know, the USJ would arrive. They would all be on the bus. Todoroki would be kind of smirking at the fact that they're saying he's the strongest. And Deku would honestly not even care. He wouldn't even pay any mind to it. He's just like, whatever. They think Todoroki's stronger. I guess I'll just have to show him some other time. As Deku's just in the back, honestly chilling. There's really nothing to go on right now. This one, they would all basically go inside, and 13 would give her annoying speech. Your powers can be used for good, but they can also be used for bad. Like, bro, they know this stuff already. Anyways, that being said, this is when Kurogiri would arrive. However, before Kurogiri even had the chance to shoot, to teleport the kids away, Deku would have immediately taken out his weapon, turned it into a minigun, and just started blasting at Kurogiri, stopping him from teleporting any of the students away. And this is when Kirishima would jump after Kurogiri, as he would miraculously, by luck actually, end up hitting Kurogiri's metal part. This is when he would hold him down, And it's at this point that Deku would look at Aizawa. Aizawa would give him a look of no. And Deku would literally turn his gun into a bow staff. As he would jump down into the area with all the villains. And he would start to beat asses. Like, this man Deku would start going hard. It's at this point that Deku would literally do these men very dirty. And Deku would proceed to obliterate all these people. It's at this point that Deku, after obliterating each and every single one of the people, more of the villains, which were on different sections that didn't have anybody teleported to them, started to arrive. And this would lead to them actually starting to swarm Deku. This is when Deku would realize that he needs to have a different approach to this. As Deku would have his gun turn into a stun gun, and it would literally just blast at all the villains as they would all get knocked out one by one, but the process is pretty slow. One of the villains would have actually gotten behind Deku and actually hit him, and this would lead to Aizawa being like jumping down there and helping Deku. This is when Deku would be like, get back here, this is not your time. As it's at this point that, you know, Deku would be like, what do you mean get back here? You don't get to decide that. Of course, Aizawa was just like, I'm your teacher, I can decide that. As he just punches some guy square in the nose, the guy would fall down bleeding. And it's at this point that, well, Shigaraki would start scratching his neck saying, they're cheating. As he looks at the Nomu and says, Nomu, kill that brat. It's at this point that the Nomu would literally rush at Deku. However, before the Nomu got the chance to even jump on Deku, Deku would literally grab Aizawa's scarf, be like, thanks, as he would wrap it around the Nomu's arm and use some gymnast type move to wrap around the Nomu's neck. As Deku would proceed to use Aizawa's scarf perfectly. Matter of fact, he would use his scarf techniques even better than Aizawa. And it's at this point that he would actually be able to restrain the Nomu for just enough time for Deku to turn his staff into a literal scythe. He would literally use that scythe to proceed to chop that Nomu's head off. And it's at this point that Deku would turn towards Shigaraki's direction. However, Deku is not fast enough to get to Shigaraki. So this would lead to Kurogiri barely escaping from Kirishima, teleporting Shigaraki away. And right as Shigaraki gets dropped off at the bar, he would look towards Kurogiri's direction and say, did you see the blonde boy? As Kurogiri would be like, I did, sir. As Shigaraki would say, bring me. This is when Kurogiri would teleport back after the heroes thought everything was over, grab Bakugo with nobody looking, and teleport him away. As everybody except for Deku would have been oblivious to what just happened. Deku would have watched as Bakugo was taken away by Kurogiri. And as soon as he got back, Kurogiri immediately knocked Bakugo out. And Shigaraki would be looking at Bakugo as he says, the kid has potential. We need to groom him to become a villain. As Kurogiri would be like, yes, sir. It's at this point that he would talk to All For One, and All For One would get some stuff arranged. It's at this point that, of course, they would realize his potential, and this is when Bakugo would finally wake up. However, when he does, he would get knocked out by Mr. Compress, who had just arrived. And this would lead to, finally, us cutting back to the hero side. At this point, All Might got there and basically got the bad news of Bakugo's disappearance. This would lead to the heroes essentially starting to look for Bakugo, and this is when they would basically hold a conference meeting with everything that's essentially going down happening. And it would basically go on record or statements that Aizawa was the one that did all the saving and all the fighting against the villains, even though it was Deku, just due to the fact that not only did a student get kidnapped, but if they were to find out that a student was the one who saved them all, UA would have definitely gone under. So they would have asked the students to keep that under wraps. This is when, while all of that is happening, Bakugo would wake up once again in a dark, dimly lit room, as he would see a giant chair. This is when Bakugo would look at that direction and say, where am I? He would look towards All For One's direction and he would say, who the hell are you? As All For One would look towards Bakugo and say, my name is All For One. This is when Bakugo would say, what kind of horrible name is that? Let me go, or else I'll send you 6 feet under. As All For One would start chuckling, he would clap. He would say, you know, kid, for somebody who's aspiring to be a hero, you sure have some villain tendencies. Bakugo would look at him and say, what the hell do you know? As All For One would say, oh, I know a lot. And this is when he would turn towards his direction and say, I know that there's a kid who's been giving you a lot of trouble, but if you join me, I can grant you power. unfathomable power which you will finally be able to use to defeat that pain in the side. Cause trust me, kid, I know about pains. All Might, he's been a pain on my side for years. I think it's time I help you take yours down, if you can help me take mine. Bakugo's eyes would light up as he would look towards Offer One's direction and say, I can't even take out that kid who might as well be quirkless, and you expect me to help you take down the symbol of peace? Not happening. You might as well just kill me now because there's nothing I'll be able to do. This one Offer One would look at him and say, but you will. As he would put his hand over Bakugo's face, he would immediately start screaming as Offer One would charge in two brand new quirks, one by the name of Double Impact, and the other, a Danger Sense quirk. Not exactly as good as the one that Deku has in the manga, however, it is very, very strong and potent at that. He has the ability to basically dodge attacks which he would have never been able to dodge before, but it's not as refined as Deku's Danger Sense. It's about as strong as the original Danger Sense without One For All powering it up. That being said, after realizing what Offer One had done, Bakugo would immediately change his mind and join the villain. As it's at this point that Mitsuki, she would be angry, searching for her son, yelling at Yue, just like going totally haywire. And it's at this point that Deku would be upset. We now switch back over to our main character's perspective, and Deku would be upset, thinking that if he was only a bit stronger, he might have been able to grab Shigaraki and bargain for Bakugo, but he was too slow. It's after this point that school would basically be closed down, and it would be closed for about 1 month entirely. The festival would get pushed back, and this would mean that Bakugo has exactly 1 month that he's been training with the villains. So Bakugo got exponentially stronger. Offer One trained Shigaraki by throwing him with Gigantomachia, and he got so much improvement from that. Now imagine what Bakugo can do with his already like incredible talent, his fighting prowess, the fact that he doesn't have anything holding him back, and the fact that he now has two brand new quirks. Yeah, Bakugo is definitely going to grow a lot more than any of you guys could ever imagine. That being said, this is when he basically starts asking around. Or no, not Bakugo, but Deku. See, after the 1 month, the UA Sports Festival finally would arrive. However, the day of the sports festival, Deku wouldn't show up. For the past month, Deku has been asking around, using his intelligence and tech to track down Bakugo. Until finally, on the day of the UA Sports Festival, Deku found a location. He immediately got his stuff, and instead of reporting to the actual place, he would go to the sports festival. Where? This is when Deku would finally be able to track down Bakugo back to that bar. Back to that place where Deku needs to pull Bakugo out of. Because they may not see eye to eye, but Deku's not going to let Bakugo down. He may have caused a lot of things to happen when they were kids. And yeah, Bakugo may have bullied him, but he doesn't deserve to die. Not like this. If Bakugo goes down, he's gonna go down fighting. And oh, Deku, you have no idea how right you are. That being said, this is when Deku would arrive at the bar. As he would open one of the windows in the back, this is when Deku would throw his shield full force at Kurogiri's direction, knocking Kurogiri to the ground and out cold. As it's at this point that Deku would jump down and create a katana as he would slice off Shigaraki's arms. It's at this point that Shigaraki would look at his arms as they would pour out, and Deku would just kick Shigaraki into the wall. As Shigaraki would drop and he would pass out due to, you know, blood loss. It's at this point that Bakugo would turn the corner as he's wiping sweat off of himself with a towel, and Deku would look at him as he would say, Bakugo? No, he would say, Kachan, let's go. This one Bakugo would look towards Deku and say, Deku, I was wondering when you would arrive. As Deku would look at Bakugo and say, what are you talking about? Deku would look at Bakugo and say, come on, we gotta go, there's not a lot of time. My memory's telling me that someone should arrive very shortly, let's go. Bakugo would look at Deku, and as Deku grabs his arm, Bakugo would shoot a full power explosion right at Deku's face, as Deku would get blown back. However, the second he hits the ground, another explosion would go off right in Deku's face with twice the power, as that explosion would do two times the damage, and Deku would get extremely weakened after that. It's at this point that Deku would say, why Bakugo? As Bakugo would look at Deku and say, you've embarrassed me since we were kids. You embarrassed me the other day, and I've been living with that for years. Now, You're gonna know what it feels like to feel a fate worse than death. As Bakugo would rush at Deku, he'd pick him up with both arms and throw him at one of the walls. As Deku would barely catch himself before taking the full force of the impact, Deku would turn his gun into a small knife, and he would rush at Bakugo as Bakugo would throw explosions at Deku, which he would dodge, but the second impact would always catch Deku off guard. This is when Deku would basically activate one of the features on his suit, which can basically let him see into the future a tiny bit. He has his own little version of Danger Sense within his suit, something that's even more potent than Bakugo's. As it's at this point that Deku would say something that would definitely lean towards Bakugo's pride. He would say, "Look, Bakugo, you may be strong, but without those quirks, you'd be nothing." As Bakugo would hear that, he'd say, "I don't need a quirk to beat you." It's immediately when Bakugo would stop using them, Deku would take advantage of this and land multiple blows on Deku. As they would both be going basically blow to blow, Deku would be having the upper hand the entire time. It's kind of like Black Widow versus Taskmaster when they first encountered each other, where she was just taking a fat L, except imagine the L multiplied by 4. That's what happened to Bakugo. However, this is when Bakugo would actually use one of his gauntlets as he blasted straight at Deku and shoots one of his own explosions, plus double impact, causing Deku to crash straight into the wall and fall onto his knees as Deku would say, "What, Bakugo?" This is when All For One would come into the room just barely as he gets to see the finale. As All For One would see what had just happened, Bakugo standing over Deku as he would say, "You know, Deku, I've been waiting a long time for this." He would look at Deku, pick him up by the hair, and then say, "No matter what you do, I was always destined to be greater. From the moment I got my quirk, and the second you got yours was just the day you died." As he would drop Deku, spit on his face, he would then turn towards All For One as he would say, "Stop. We need to end him now." As Bakugo would look at All For One, he would then say, "No, you leave him alone. He's mine. And you know what? There's some fates far worse than death." As All For One would look at him, smile under the mask, he would then go over to Shigaraki as he would steal the quirk. And after this, they would leave. This is where we're going to be ending part 3 for What If Deku Was Taskmaster. This one was probably the most action-packed, fast-paced episodes that I have done of this series. So if you guys enjoyed this part, please smash that like button, boys. Come on, I work hard on this script. I know the video may not have been as long as my other ones. However, your boy trying to bring you the best content I can. Whether that be 8 minutes long, 20 minutes long, 30 minutes long. Hope you guys appreciate it at the end of the day. That being said, make sure you guys share the video with a friend. Check the links down in the description for more things that I have. Check out the Akatsuki channel in case you want to see more What Ifs, if you've seen all of them on the channel. And with that being said, I love each and every single one of you guys. It has been your boy Zether, and I am out. Peace.